Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 9th July 2019. The list of articles which has been chosen for today's analysis along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions are provided here. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping for the displayed articles is provided in the description box below. And for the benefit of smartphone users, the timestamping is also provided in the comments section. Let's move on to our first article discussion. This article is an editorial about the reservation to the Maratha community of the Maharashtra state. The discussion is relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national importance, then in Indian polity, particularly under rights issues. Next, it is also relevant in economic and social development, also under sustainable development, poverty and inclusion. Then the discussion can also be linked to main syllabus under social empowerment of GS paper 1. Then the discussion can be linked to GS paper 2 under the area government policies and interventions for development in various sectors and issues arising out of their design and implementation. Next in mechanisms and laws for the protection and betterment of vulnerable sections of the population. Then also in GS paper 3, the discussion is relevant under Indian economy and issues related to planning, development and employment. Then also in inclusive growth and issues arising from it. The author in this editorial talks about reservation to the Maratha community of the Maharashtra state. The communities such as the scheduled castes, scheduled tribes and the other backward classes have been given the benefit of reservation policies because of their historical marginalization in the Indian subcontinent. But the author notes that the people have forgotten the actual meaning of the term backward and they are embracing or welcoming the term with enthusiasm. This is because many land-owning castes that are politically and economically dominant are demanding reservation in our country. In this context, the author analyzes the demand of the Maratha community based on the available data. Firstly, you should know that the Marathas were demanding reservation in jobs and in educational institutions. The demand for being classified as backward by Marathas has been ongoing since the 1990s. So, the Maharashtra government has accepted to grant the reservation. The reservation will be granted to the community under the category socially and educationally backward class communities, that is SEBC communities. The author says that the Maharashtra government has yielded to the demands of this powerful caste group. And also, this is the third attempt in the last 5 years to grant quota or reservation to the Marathas. The previous attempts were repeatedly struck down by the courts. Then the author notes that many dominant castes, which are mostly rich, land-owning and are politically influential communities, are also demanding reservations in jobs and in higher education. The communities which the author mentions here are the Marathas in Maharashtra, Patidars in Gujarat, Jats in Haryana and Kapus in Andhra Pradesh. According to the author, this indicates that the economic growth in the last two decades, that is in the last 20 years, did not benefit these communities and it did not bring these communities upward enough. So, that is why they are demanding reservation. Their demand for being included in the quota can be seen as an expression of their desire for good jobs and desire for stable sources of livelihood for the youth in their community. Now, this is because the Marathas are a predominantly agricultural community and they also benefited from the Green Revolution and White Revolution. Here, the term Green Revolution is applied to the successful agricultural experiments in many developing countries, and India is one of the countries where it was most successful. The Green Revolution resulted in a record grain output of 131 million tons in the period 1978-79. This established India as one of the world's biggest agricultural producers. Then the White Revolution made India the largest producer of milk in the world. And the benefits from these revolutions were enjoyed by many communities. One among them is Maratha community. Hence, agricultural was their traditional source of livelihood. But this traditional source of livelihood became more fragile or weak due to a widespread and multifaceted agrarian crisis, that is the agricultural crisis. So, as a result of this, the community started demanding reservations. But in today's scenario, everyone likes a good job or a decent stable source of livelihood. So, everyone will start demanding reservation. Then what should be the measure or indicator to determine the validity of the demand for quotas? For this, the author answers using the data from a survey. The survey is the Indian Human Development Survey or IHDS. The Indian Human Development Survey is a nationally representative multi-topic survey. It was carried out in some 41,500 households, which were present in 1,503 villages and 971 urban neighborhoods across India. The topics which were covered in the survey were with respect to health, education, employment, economic status, marriage, fertility, gender relations, and social capital. Now, based on this survey, the author has compared the communities in the respective states, such as Jats in Haryana, Patels in Gujarat, and Marathas in Maharashtra, with the Brahmins and non-Brahmin forward castes, existing other backward classes, and scheduled castes, scheduled tribes. Based on this comparison, the author says the results were very clear, and the author has found out the following. One is that Marathas are more likely to own or cultivate land than all other social groups in the state. Then if we consider the per capita consumption expenditure, that is the spending by households on goods and services, then the Marathas have a lower per capita consumption expenditure than Brahmins in Maharashtra. But Marathas are at the same level like the other forward castes and OBCs. Then they are significantly higher than SCs and STs in the per capita consumption expenditure. Next finding is that on an average, Marathas are as poor as Brahmins and other forward castes, but they are less poor than OBCs and SCSTs. The next finding says that the Maratha households have greater access to electricity as compared to scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. Then with respect to the access to flush toilets, the Marathas are 6 percentage points more likely to have access to flush toilets than OBCs and 14 percentage points more likely than SCs and STs. Next, the average years of education for Marathas are 6.58 years. It is lower than Brahmins, but it is similar to other forward castes and OBCs. Yet, it is 1.22 years more than the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. Now, these are the crucial socio-economic indicators. These results show that Marathas are only second to or next to Brahmins in this state. So, according to the author, this means the Marathas are significantly better and have better social and economic conditions than all other social groups. Then a question may arise that if the Marathas are better than other social groups, then why they need reservation in jobs and educational institution? For this question, the author says the main bone of contention, that is the continued disagreement and the main motivation for quotas, is the access to government jobs. Moreover, the surprising fact in the finding is that the Marathas, even before being included in the reservation quota, they already have access to government jobs similar to Brahmins in their state. And also the access to government jobs is higher than other forward castes and OBCs. But it is not different from or is almost same as the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. Actually, the IHDS or the Indian Human Development Survey was carried out in two rounds. One was in 2010 and other was in 2005. The author has examined both the rounds of the IHDS data. This is to see whether the position of the dominant communities have deteriorated or not as compared to the other groups. The examination has revealed that there is no such deterioration. This is because in terms of average per capita expenditure, the position of Marathas have improved in the second round. Then in terms of probability of being poor, the Maratha community is at the same level like in round one, which means there is no worsening. But if we see the probability of owning land or cultivating land, we can see some evidence of decline here. This means that the Maratha community owns less land or cultivates less land than they did in the round one. The author says this could be the reason for their heightened anxiety to get reservation. Next, the author lists some other factors that are the reason for the anxiety. As we saw earlier, the Marathas are a predominantly agricultural community which benefited from the green and white revolutions. So the author says the factor for the anxiety could be the structural transformation of the Indian economy, then especially the declining importance of agriculture also, then also the growth of corporates in the agriculture, and also the water shortages which are affecting the productivity of the land. All these factors are drastically affecting the farming ability of the community. This is the reason the communities feel increasingly vulnerable and they want to fight the poverty by getting reservations. Then another factor is that the data and the findings are showing that the Marathas have lower levels of casualization of the labor force. Casualization means the transformation of a workforce from permanent contracts to a short-term or casual basis jobs. The author says in the Maratha community, this casualization in both the sectors, namely the agricultural and non-agricultural sectors, are lower as compared to the OBCs and the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. Then another reason or factor which the author points to is that there is discontent or dissatisfaction or unhappiness among the powerful farming communities. This is due to the perception of the community that real economic power lies in the hands of big corporations and the government. And these big corporations and the government acts in the community's interests both overtly and covertly, that is openly and secretly. You may think, what is wrong in these? The corporates and the government is acting in the community's interests only, so it will benefit the community. The problem is that the communities feel their power is slipping away or the power is eroding from them. Then in addition to this, they have a feeling that they are ill-prepared or not ready to shift towards the urban and formal sector livelihood opportunities. So the author notes that the economic changes that give rise to widespread anxieties definitely need to be understood. And also the genuine grievances that come even from the forward castes which are dealing with the agrarian transformation needs to be addressed. But the author questions whether reservation is the real answer for such grievances or not. The author says it is not so, because there is already an increase in privatization. This privatization is leading to the shrinking of available total jobs that are eligible for reservations. And also the research shows that the OBCs and the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes are further lagging behind the upper castes on a range of socio-economic indicators. So in this context, the extending of quotas to relatively richer and powerful groups will amount to the diluting the entitlement of reservation for the OBCs and the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. This is because the reservation is already small and the entitlement is already shrinking for the OBCs and the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe communities that are truly disadvantaged and discriminated. And also the author notes that the new 10% quota plan for the economically weaker sections means that the government does not aim to move to a caste-free system. Moreover, it is to dilute the entitlement of castes that are objectively backward, stigmatized and discriminated against. The author concludes that the backward communities are already facing many problems in our country, such as the lynching of Dalits for pursuing their traditional occupations, then snatching away their livelihoods in the name of cow protection, then the violence targeted at intercaste marriages and other violence related to temple entry or violence for not following the illegal social norms dictated by untouchability, etc. Now, if the reservation is also given, the author feels that this move would legally reinforce the obnoxious or unpleasant hierarchies of the caste system. So the author finishes by saying that a forward-looking and progressive Indian polity should be discussing the instruments that will weaken the caste system, and the Indian polity should not embolden or encourage and reinforce the existing hierarchies. With this, we have come to the end of this discussion. This displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next article discussion, which is about the Stand Up India scheme. The analysis of this news article will be relevant in prelims preparation under current events of national importance and then also under economic and social development, particularly in social sector initiatives. The analysis will also be relevant in mains preparation under General Studies Paper 2 in the area Government Policies and Interventions for Development in Various Sectors and Issues Arising Out of Their Design and Implementation. Then also in Welfare Schemes for the Vulnerable Sections of the Population by the Centre and the Performance of these Schemes. Then the discussion can also be linked to GS paper 3 under the area inclusive growth. To understand the news article, let us first know about the Stand Up India scheme. It is a scheme for financing women entrepreneurs and financing the entrepreneurs from scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. It was launched in the year 2016. Here, entrepreneur means a business person who sets up a business or businesses by taking the financial risks in the hope of getting profit from the business. The objective of this scheme is that at least one person from scheduled caste or one person from scheduled tribes who is borrowing or one woman borrower per bank branch should be given a loan by the bank so that she or he can set up a greenfield enterprise. Here, greenfield enterprise means for the first time, the loan beneficiary is setting up a business to become an entrepreneur. This enterprise or business can be set up either in manufacturing sector, services sector or trading sector. Apart from getting loans for setting up greenfield enterprises, the entrepreneurs can also get loans for non-individual enterprises. But the condition is that they should hold at least 51% of the shareholding and controlling stake in that enterprise. Here, non-individual enterprise means an enterprise which involves more than one person. The eligible entrepreneurs will receive a composite loan from the bank. See, composite loans are a type of loans which includes both working capital and term loans. Working capital means the money that the company needs for its day-to-day operations. Next, term loans are loans from a bank for a specific amount that has a specified repayment schedule and a fixed or floating interest rate. In this case, it is a fixed interest rate. Also know that this Stand Up India scheme would be operated by all the branches of scheduled commercial banks in India. There is also a web portal which is available to guide the entrepreneurs to avail the loans for establishing their enterprises. This Stand Up India scheme is managed by the Department of Financial Services, which comes under the Ministry of Finance. One more recent news with respect to the Stand Up India scheme is that in the recent Union Budget, which was tabled in Parliament, the Finance Minister has said that the Stand Up India scheme has been extended up to the year 2025. Now, let us come to the news article discussion. The news mentions that the state of Tamil Nadu has lagged behind targets that have been set under the Stand Up India scheme. According to the progress report by the State Level Bankers Committee, in the financial year 2018-19, banks in Tamil Nadu have disbursed loan worth 157 crore rupees under the Stand Up India scheme. During the financial year 2017-18, loans worth 133 crore rupees were disbursed. The State Level Bankers Committee has requested the scheduled commercial banks to actively involve themselves in the implementation of the scheme. It has asked them to quickly process the applications and disperse more loans to the eligible entrepreneurs. With this, we have come to the end of this discussion. The split practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next article discussion, which is an editorial about the African Continental Free Trade Agreement for Goods and Services and how India should make use of this agreement. The analysis of this editorial will be relevant in your mains preparation in GS paper 2 under regional groupings and agreements affecting India's interests, and then also under effect of policies and politics of developing countries on India's interests. In this editorial, the author states that the 12th extraordinary summit of African Union was held at Niamey, which is the capital of Niger Republic. In this summit, 54 out of 55 member states of African Union have signed the African Continental Free Trade Agreement for Goods and Services. Out of these 54 countries, 27 countries have already ratified this agreement. Though the agreement has been signed now, the actual cross-border free trade will start by July 2020 only. Once the free trade agreement is in force, the customs duty will be eliminated for at least 90% of the tariff lines. Here, tariff lines means good or a service that is listed in the tariff list. Then after this free trade agreement comes into force, it will create an African common market with a population of 1.2 billion and their GDP will be over 3.4 trillion US dollars. Note that in the editorial, it is wrongly mentioned as 3.4 billion US dollars, which is very lesser value. We have been recently seeing for the past 1 week that India's current GDP is 2.7 trillion US dollars and that we aim to be a $5 trillion GDP by 2024. So the author states that these values such as 1.2 billion people and 3.4 trillion US dollars are comparable with the Indian values. He also mentions that this African Continental Free Trade Agreement would be world's largest free trade agreement. Now, many of the world's powers are focusing on African markets to market or sell their goods and services. So the author notes that this free trade agreement would have a global impact. Next, the author speaks about the challenges and hopes of this African Continental Free Trade Agreement. First, he has listed three challenges about the viability or success of this free trade agreement. Firstly, the author states that the functioning of the African Union itself has not been very much successful. Know that the African Union was founded in the year 2002, and before this, it was called as the Organization of African Unity. And this Organization of African Unity was founded in 1963 itself. Now, the author states that since 1960s, this organization has not properly handled various problems such as decolonization, underdevelopment, Islamic terrorism, and the Arab Spring. Here, the Arab Spring refers to the chain of cause and effect of the protests, uprising, and armed rebellion that spread across the North Africa and Middle East in the late 2010. Also, if you see, in 2010, the then Libyan president Muammar Gaddafi came up with an idea of African Unity Project. He proposed to build a United States of Africa, which is similar to the United States of America. But then this project was a huge failure. So the author notes that this free trade agreement could also be an unsuccessful one. Secondly, the author mentions that African countries have a low manufacturing base, which means most of the products are produced in other continents and they are imported by Africa. And also, there is not much of a competition in the trade between the African countries due to various political, organizational, and logistical challenges. Here, the challenges mean most of the African countries have autocratic rulers who are still ruling for many years. And most of the African countries do not have a proper infrastructure to carry out trade activities because of poor planning. So these are the organizational and logistical challenges. Then the author mentions that only 1/6 of the Africa's current total trade is happening within the African continent. It means that Africa is largely importing goods from other countries. Thirdly, we can see the protectionism trend across the world, where the major global powers are coming up with protectionist policies like imposing trade and tariff barriers. You can especially see this in the case of USA-China trade conflict, then also in Brexit, that is the Britain's exit from the European Union in order to protect its market. We can also see some protectionist trends where the countries are not supporting any common policies at the World Trade Organization and the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development. The author then mentions that the world trade is likely to grow only by 2.6% in 2019, which is lower than 2018, where it was 3%. And Africa accounts for only 3% of global trade, which is very small proportion. So the author questions if this African Continental Free Trade Agreement would overcome this global trends and become successful or not. Firstly, we can see that China is trying to dominate the entire world through its Belt and Road Initiative. But most of the countries are becoming more cautious now to engage with China since they may fall into the debt trap of China. So the author notes that this African Continental Free Trade Agreement, which is an economic integration, actually makes sense. By this, he means that the free trade agreement is relevant as Africa would become self-reliant in trade in the future. Next, the author states that African Continental Free Trade Agreement should gain some knowledge and experience from the 5 regional economic blocs of Africa. In fact, there are 8 regional economic blocs or communities in Africa. We need not know the names of these economic blocs. Just remember that there are 8 regional economic blocs in Africa. Next, the author also mentions that the African Union has constantly failed in achieving its objectives because of its inefficient planning. But African Union has prepared an extensive roadmap towards this African Continental Free Trade Agreement. It has carried out some preliminary work on areas such as incremental tariff reduction, then elimination of non-tariff barriers, then on supply chains, and then also on dispute settlement. Then the African Union also organized the first intra-African trade fair in Cairo in December 2018. In this trade fair, business deals worth $32 billion were signed. One more point to note here is that the African companies were very much interested in signing the business deals. Next, the author mentions that the logistical and financial networks across Africa are poor, and also there are too much customs formalities between the countries. The author believes that all these challenges can be overcome if there is a stronger political will. That is, if all the political leaders of Africa are willing to improve their country's infrastructure, then the challenges can be overcome. One immediate action that has to be taken is to stop the informal trade that is happening across the national borders of Africa, since most of the borders of Africa are open and unprotected. Then the author mentions the World Population Prospect 2019 Highlights Report. It is published by the Population Division of the UN Department of Economic and Social Affairs. In this report, it is told that the population of sub-Saharan Africa will double by the year 2050 to nearly 2 billion. So we can see that there will be a huge consumer base by 2050 in Africa. And hence, the author notes that this free trade agreement is more relevant. Next, the author discusses about what India can gain from this African Continental Free Trade Agreement. The author has given some statistics about India-Africa trade relations. You can use them in your mains answer writing. He mentions that Africa is an important economic partner for India. This is because the total annual merchandise trade is estimated to be $70 billion, and it is nearly 1/10 of India's global trade. And also, India is Africa's third largest trading partner. The author then states that India's global exports have largely remained the same, but India's exports to Africa have increased. For example, the exports to Nigeria grew by over 33% in 2018-19 when compared to 2017-18. But still, most of Africa's demands for goods and services are unfulfilled. So, this African Continental Free Trade Agreement is a huge trade opportunity for India. We can see that the African economy would become formal and transparent. So, the author suggests that India needs to make use of this to increase the economic relations with Africa. He also suggests that Indian companies can set up factories and co-produce the goods and services in Africa with the African workers. So, it would be a win-win situation for both India and Africa. Moreover, this free trade agreement is likely to open new opportunities for Indian stakeholders in manufacturing of fast-moving consumer goods, then in the infrastructure and connectivity projects. So, this would also make the African economy strong. See, India has donated around $15 million to Niger to fund the NAIMI African Union Summit. So, the author suggests that next India can help the African Union Commission to prepare the required architecture for this free trade agreement, such as common external tariffs, competition policy, intellectual property rights, and natural persons movements. Know that African Union Commission is the secretariat of African Union. Then India can also identify various African transnational corporations which are expected to play a greater role in the future African common market, and India can engage with them strategically. Next, the author suggests that India should utilize the potential of Indian diaspora. Around 3 million, that is 30 lakh people of Indian origin, are spread across Africa. So, engaging them would be a valuable asset for India. Finally, the author suggests that once the African Continental Free Trade Agreement is successful, then the African political leaders could think of signing an India-African Free Trade Agreement also. So, both India and Africa would be largely benefited. Finally, the author has concluded with a small history of how Africa traded in the medieval times. He mentions that before Africa was discovered by the West, it had a thriving, that is flourishing, overland trade. Large camel caravans were used to transport all the commodities across various trading centers of Africa. So the internal trade and trade routes were already present in Africa, but the colonialism and mercantilism by the West had destroyed the internal trade routes. So Africa started to trade mostly with the foreign nations instead of trading among themselves like they used to do in the medieval times. The author calls this as a historic distortion. So the author concludes that by this African Continental Free Trade Agreement, the Africans are only trying to correct this historic distortion. With this, we have come to the end of this discussion. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next article discussion, which is about the automated facial recognition system. The discussion is relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national importance, then in Indian polity and governance. The discussion can be linked to GS paper 2 under the area government interventions for development in various sectors. Next, in important aspects of e-governance, its applications, models and potential. Then the discussion can also be linked to GS paper 3 under science and technology, its developments and their applications and effects in everyday life. Then also in basics of cyber security. The news article states that the National Crime Records Bureau, that is NCRB, has invited bids for the automated facial recognition system. So, what is this automated facial recognition system? The automated facial recognition system, or AFRS, is an automatic identification and verification of persons. This identification and verification will be from digital images, photos, digital sketches, video frames, and video sources. It will be done by the comparison of selected facial features of the image with an already existing image database. The National Crime Records Bureau has conceptualized this automated facial recognition system. The AFRS will be a centralized web application and it will be hosted or introduced at the NCRB data center situated in Delhi. Also know that the NCRB was set up in the year 1986 to function as a repository of information on crime and criminals. This is to assess the investigators in linking the crime to the perpetrators or criminals. NCRB's main objective is to create and maintain a secure and shareable national database on crimes and criminals. This is for the law enforcement agencies and to promote the use of national database for public service delivery also. The automated facial recognition system is an effort in the direction of modernizing the police force, then to modernize the gathering of information for criminal identification, verification, and also for the dissemination or circulation of such information among various police organizations and police units across the country. So, why is it important? It is important because the availability of relevant and timely information is of utmost necessity for police, particularly in the investigation of crime and in tracking and detection of the criminals. The police organizations have been handling large amounts of information and huge volume of records pertaining or concerning to the crime and criminals. Hence, the automated facial recognition system can play a vital role in improving the outcomes in the area of criminal identification and verification. The AFRS will facilitate easy recording, easy analysis, easy retrieval and easy sharing of information between different organizations. So, the creation of database of photographs and maintaining it in the digital form for sharing by all the stakeholders in the system is very essential to effectively meet the challenges of criminal identification and verification. We can say that a facial recognition system is a great investigation enhancer. It can be used for the identification of criminals, for the identification of missing children or missing person, for the identification of unidentified dead bodies, and also for the identification of unknown traced children or persons. The stakeholders of this project are Ministry of Home Affairs or NCRB and the state police. The NCRB will create a repository of photographs of criminals in the country. Then through the AFRS, there will be an enhanced ability to detect crime patterns and modus operandi, that is the mode of operation of the criminals across the states. then this information will be communicated to the state police departments for aiding or supporting in the prevention of crime. So, what are the expected functions of this AFRS? The AFRS repository shall act as a foundation for a national level searchable platform of facial images. Then the system shall offer logical algorithms, user-friendly and simple graphical user interface. These elements will make the facial matching as an easy task to perform. Then it will capture face images from CCTV feed or recording. Then it will generate alerts if a match of the face of a blacklisted person is found in the CCTV feed. The system shall be able to broadly match a suspect or criminal photograph with the photograph images already available with existing databases of the government. The databases includes a passport database, crime and criminal tracking network and systems, or in short CCTNS database, the database of interoperable criminal justice system or ICJS database, and the database of prisons. Then the database of Ministry of Women and Child Development, which is known as Khoya Paya. Here Khoya means lost and Paya means found. So Khoya Paya is a portal which is a citizen-based website for exchanging the information on missing and found children. Then the AFRS should also match the database of state or national automated fingerprint identification system or any other image database which is available with police or other entity. Then another expected function is that it will add photographs obtained from different sources to the criminals repository along with sex, age, scars, tattoos, etc. The various sources include newspapers, raids, photographs sent by people and sketches, etc. Along with the all mentioned functions, the AFRS will also provide information security and data protection. The data needs to be protected against the threats such as unauthorized access to database or application. Then it will protect accidental modification or deletion to the available data. Then it will enable confidentiality, integrity and availability of data during data transport and physical storage. Then it will provide for the encryption and decryption engine for the encryption or decryption of records while storing or loading the records to and from the database. Here, encryption means converting the data into code to prevent unauthorized access to data, and decryption means converting the code back to the original data. With this, we have come to the end of this discussion. Moving on to the last discussion for the day, which is about the amendments made in the Aadhaar Bill. The analysis of this news article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance, then also under Indian polity and governance, particularly in constitution. Then the analysis will also be relevant in mains preparation under GS paper 2 in the area Indian constitution, amendments and significant provisions. The Aadhaar and other laws amendment bill of 2019 is a bill which has amended the Aadhaar targeted delivery of financial and other subsidies, benefits and services act of 2016, or in short, it has amended the Aadhaar Act of 2016. And further, this bill will amend the Indian Telegraph Act of 1885, and the bill will also amend the Prevention of Money Laundering Act of 2002. Now, know that the Aadhaar Act of 2016 was introduced and passed as a money bill in the Lok Sabha. Now, let us see what is meant by money bill and some of the important features of money bill. As per Article 109 of Indian Constitution, the money bill can be introduced only in Lok Sabha, that is the House of People, and not in Rajya Sabha, that is the Council of States. A money bill must be passed in Lok Sabha by a simple majority of all members present and voting. After a money bill has been passed by Lok Sabha, it shall be sent to Rajya Sabha for its recommendations. And Rajya Sabha is bound to send its recommendations of the bill within 14 days from the date it has received the bill. If the recommendations are not given by Rajya Sabha within 14 days, then the bill is deemed to be passed in Lok Sabha. Also, it is up to the Lok Sabha to accept or reject the recommendations made by Rajya Sabha. As per Article 110 of Indian Constitution, if any question arises whether a bill is a money bill or not, then the decision of the Speaker of the Lok Sabha will be final. So in this context, let us see the news article. The Lok Sabha had passed the Aadhaar and Other Laws Amendment Bill of 2019 on 4th July 2019 and it sent the bill to Rajya Sabha for recommendations. And Rajya Sabha has cleared the bill yesterday and it sent back the bill back to Lok Sabha. Once the president gives his assent to the bill, then this bill will become an act. The Aadhaar Act of 2016 was enacted to provide good governance, efficient, transparent and targeted delivery of subsidies, benefits and services to the citizens. The expenditure incurred to deliver these services is taken from the Consolidated Fund of India. Hence, this bill was introduced as a money bill as per Article 110, Clause 1, Subclause C of Indian Constitution. This amendment bill will allow the citizen to voluntarily use Aadhaar as proof of identity to open bank accounts and to get mobile phone connections. So, any individual cannot be denied services on the grounds that Aadhaar authentication is not done. And it will allow the authentication of offline verification of Aadhaar number, which can be performed only with the informed consent of the Aadhaar number holder. Next, the amendment bill will also give an option to children who are Aadhaar number holders to cancel their Aadhaar number once they have attained the age of 18 years. The amendment bill also seeks to establish Unique Identification Authority of India fund. The amendment bill also provides for a 1 crore rupees as penalty and a jail term for private entities who are violating the provisions on Aadhaar data. Then the opposition parties in the Rajya Sabha have questioned the government's intention on clearing the bill without first bringing in a law for data protection. Because we are often seeing in the news that the citizens' biometric information which was given for Aadhaar is not being protected properly. The government had told the opposition parties in the Rajya Sabha that the legislation on data protection is in progress and that the government would bring in a comprehensive law after further consultations with the stakeholders. The government has said that the Aadhaar was completely safe and sound with all necessary encryptions and the data is protected. With this, we have come to the end of our analysis sessions. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the next session. Moving on to the last session for the day, that is the practice questions discussion session. If you look at the first question, it is based on Stand Up India. Two statements have been given. We have to choose the correct statements. Now, if you look at the first statement, it is correct. Because during our analysis, we saw that Stand Up India scheme is a scheme for financing women entrepreneurs and also the entrepreneurs from scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. And we also saw that the objective of this scheme is to facilitate bank loans, which amounts between 10 lakh to 1 crore. So this means statement 1 is correct. Now, if you look at the second statement, it mentions that the scheme is managed by the Ministry of Women and Child Development. Now, if you see, in the first statement, we have said that the first statement is correct and the scheme is for women entrepreneurs and for also for the entrepreneurs from scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. But if you see, the ministry which is given here is with respect to women and child development. So, we can say here the scheduled castes and scheduled tribe individuals are not included. So, we can say if the statement 1 is correct, then logically statement 2 will be incorrect. So, this statement is wrong. But also know that the scheme is managed by the Department of Financial Services, which comes under the Ministry of Finance. The question has asked for the correct statement. Since statement 1 is the correct statement, the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 only. Now, if you look at the next question, it is about the money bill. Two statements have been given here. We have to choose the correct statement. Now, here the first statement states a money bill can be introduced in both the houses of parliament. Now, during our analysis, we saw that the money bill can be introduced in Lok Sabha, that is the House of People. And once the bill has been passed by Lok Sabha, it shall send the bill to Rajya Sabha for its recommendation. And the Rajya Sabha is bound to give its recommendations within 14 days. But we never mentioned that the bill will be introduced in Rajya Sabha. So, remember that a money bill is introduced only in Lok Sabha, not in both the houses. So, this statement is wrong. Now, if you look at the second statement, it states that if any question arises whether a bill is a money bill or not, then the decision of the Speaker of the Lok Sabha is final. Yes, this statement is correct. Because as per Article 110 of Indian Constitution, if any question arises whether a bill is amenable or not, the decision of the Speaker of Lok Sabha is the final decision. So the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only. Now let us see one mains question based on GS paper 2. Indian polity should weaken the caste system, not embolden or reinforce it. Discuss in the context of quota for new communities. Now you can start your answer by saying that the communities such as scheduled castes, scheduled tribes and the other backward classes have been given the benefit of reservation policies because of their historic marginalization in the Indian subcontinent. But the new communities who are demanding reservation are mainly land-owning castes that are politically and economically dominant. Here, the question asks for us to discuss. So, you have to state both the positives and negatives about this statement. So, for positives, you can say that you can take the example of Maratha community and you can say that it is an agricultural community and their traditional source of livelihood is agriculture, and due to the agrarian crisis they are facing many problems like the growth of corporatization in agriculture, then the water shortages which is affecting the production. Then you can also say that the communities are ill prepared to shift to urban formal sector livelihood opportunities, etc. Then for negatives, you can mention that already the reservation for the other backward castes and the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes is shrinking due to privatization. These castes are already lagging behind the forward castes. And also if reservation is given, then it means the diluting of entitlement for the disadvantaged and discriminated communities. Then you can say that the backward communities are already facing many problems in our country, such as lynching of Dalits for pursuing their traditional occupations, then violence related to temple entry or violence for not following the illegal social norms dictated by untouchability, etc. Then if the reservation is given, you can say that it will legally reinforce the obnoxious or unpleasant hierarchies of the caste system. You can also add your own viewpoints based on today's discussion. Now let us see another mains question based on GS paper 2. India-Africa enjoys cordial relations in all aspects but has not materialized in terms of potential it offers. Discuss African Continental Free Trade Agreement in the context of the above statement. Now if you see here, the first statement is a fact that India-Africa enjoys cordial relations in all aspects but has not materialized in terms of potential it offers. So here you can mention some statistics to show the poor relations between India and Africa in terms of trade, since the second part of the question is regarding the African Continental Free Trade Agreement. Then the main part which has to be addressed in this question is the second part, which asks you to discuss the African Continental Free Trade Agreement. So you can discuss the challenges and also the opportunities that this African Continental Free Trade Agreement will have with respect to India. We have seen the challenges of this African Free Trade Agreement and also what India will gain from this free trade agreement in our editorial discussion. Like you can mention about how the African Union since its inception was unsuccessfully functioning. Then you can mention about the low manufacturing base of Africa. Then you can also talk about the protectionist trend which is present across the world. Then for the part about what India will gain from this free trade agreement, you can say that African economy is set to become formal and transparent, and India should increase the economic relations with Africa since its population or the is high and it is a good market for India. Then also you can talk about the Indian diaspora which is present in Africa and how we can utilize that Indian diaspora for our benefit. Then you can also say if this free trade agreement goes well, then India and Africa can separately have a India-African free trade agreement which will benefit both the countries. And you can also add your own viewpoints based on today's discussion. With this, we have come to the end of our today's sessions. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates on civil service examination preparation.